Okay, another supplemental lecture by Dr. Martin, continuing our survey of the animal kingdom. The next phylum that I want to talk about is the phylum Arthropoda, and we're going to talk about some general characteristics first. These are simply known as arthropods. So, general features that are common to all of the members of this group. This is a very prolific and large group. In fact, there are more species in this phyla than any of the other phyla that we're going to talk about. Currently, there are 1 million species of arthropods known, but some experts hypothesize or speculate that there might actually be closer to 10 million species on the planet. So it's a very successful group too. So prolific, large, and successful. All right, another thing I want to point out is the body. And there are three characteristics that I want to emphasize with regard to this group. Number one, we'll make it A, segmentation. The body is divided into segments. In some of the arthropods, clusters of segments can fuse to form to perform a certain function. But nonetheless, we see segmentation. Another characteristic is that they have jointed appendages. In other words, there are joints in their feet. Or legs, whatever, they're, as mentioned, appendages. And in fact, the name Arthropoda comes from this characteristic. Jointed, the first part, arthro, refers to joints, and appendages, poda. Okay, one last characteristic that you probably already know, that is the arthropods have a hard outer skeleton. It's called an exoskeleton. It is composed of protein and a carbohydrate called chitin. All right, another characteristic, we're going to come back to some of these body forms and talk about them maybe in a little more detail. Let's go ahead and do it here. Segmentation. Generally, we can see specialization among the segments to form maybe three body parts, the head, a thorax, and an abdomen. The exoskeleton, I think I've already mentioned, is made up of chitin, but one of the important features of the exoskeleton, one of its functions, is that it prevents water loss. And so this characteristic allowed the ancestral arthropods to move from an aqueous environment onto land, and they then branched out into many different groups, as we'll talk about a little bit later. Okay, well, another feature, however, of the exoskeleton is that it does not grow like our skeleton does. So because of that, periodically the organism has to actually shed its old exoskeleton, and that's called molting, and it has to make a new exoskeleton. So typically the new exoskeleton is made underneath the old exoskeleton. The old one is then, it actually splits down the middle, and the organism emerges from that old exoskeleton. The new exoskeleton is not completely hardened, so the organism is somewhat vulnerable at that time. It takes a little while for the chitin and other parts of the exoskeleton to harden so that it's protective. All right, so those are two really important characteristics. I'm going to add some more, but like I said, this one right here is kind of the essence of the group as far as major characteristics. So let's go to point number three. So let's talk a little bit about some other systems. It does have an open circulatory system, and you recall in these organisms there might be a heart, there most likely is, that is able to pump blood. So there's blood vessels that lead away from the heart, but at some point then the blood leaves the vascular system and bathes the organs and then will return to the heart to become oxygenated. Okay. Respiration is certainly very different from the respiratory system in vertebrates that we'll deal with in the cat. The organs of the respiratory system vary depending on the environment. So if we're talking about a terrestrial arthropod, in other words, one that lives on land, they're going to have tubes that are lined with chitin. And these tubes are called trachea. The tubes will enter the body and branch many times, and their purpose is to bring oxygen close to the tissues of the body. So these tubes connect to the outside. If you look at I'm not going to be able to draw this guy. A grasshopper, look along the body of the grasshopper. You can see little tiny openings along the abdomen. And those are openings that lead into the trachea. These openings actually can be They can be closed to prevent water loss, and they're called spiracles. So they can be opened or closed. In the case of, aquatic arthropods, those forms have gills. Okay, that's everything I want to say about the general features of the arthropods. There's several groups. Let me talk about the groups. So arthropods include a number of groups that are still living, and we're going to talk about each of these. So the first group that we're going to talk about are the arachnids, which are the spiders and some other creatures fall into that group. The crustaceans are another group of arthropods. And so these would be lobster, crayfish, so on. Of course, we have the insects. A very important group, and we're going to talk about those in some detail. And there's, I don't think I've forgotten anybody. There are some extinct groups, obviously. All right, let's talk about the spiders, the arachnids. So, arachnids, these include the spiders, scorpions, ticks, and mites. Those are all included in this group. The arachnids. The body form, it's a little modified from the generalized body form that I mentioned earlier with the head, a thorax, and an abdomen. In this case, we have a head and a second. Have a head that's fused with the thorax. It's called the cephalothorax, and we have an abdomen. So we actually have two body sections. Another characteristic is that we have four pairs of legs. So in other words, we have eight legs, and that's in contrast to the insects, which have six legs or three pairs. Okay, another feature of this group has to do with the mouth parts. Let's see. There are two pairs of structures that make up the mouth parts, and they are the chelicera and the pedipalps. So if you look at the anterior portion of a spider, if the spider is staring at you, the structures that appear to be closest to its mouth that are paired are the chelicera. And these are generally fang-like, or sometimes pincer-like. They are used, as you can tell from my description of fangs, they're used to deliver a venom or a chemical, enzyme, whatever, that is used to kill or subdue prey. The second set of mouth parts are on the periphery of the clycera. So the clycera are closest to the mouth, and then on either side of the clycera are the pedipalps, and they are like fingers. And their function is to manipulate the prey or the food to bring it into the mouth. So these two structures have slightly different characteristics. Let's go on here. So we're on number four. This group is almost all terrestrial. They are predators. They all make a protein that's called silk. And the organs that produce this material are called spinnerets. And they're located at the very tip of the abdomen. The silk, of course, you're most familiar with spiders that make webs. But some silk is used to wrap the prey. Some silk is used to cover a burrow. There's many different uses for this material. All right, another characteristic here is that we see adaptations to terrestrial life. Certainly one of those is the presence of an exoskeleton. There are also special kidney-like organs that reduce water loss, H2O loss. That's very important. So those are a couple of features of that represent adaptations. All right, let's talk about some of the groups within the arachnids. And I'll show you in the next video clip, I'll show you a diagram. So we've got the spiders, certainly one group. These are predators. They all make silk for various purposes. another group you might be familiar with are the scorpions. So they're included in the arachnids, and they are also predators. But they are nocturnal, so they tend to feed at night. They mostly live in desert areas. They primarily eat insects. Spiders. As you probably know, the tail bears a stinger, and a couple of the mouth parts, the pedipalps, are actually modified to form pincer-like structures. Okay, the last two I'm going to throw together, so listing four. And those, actually I'm going to maybe erase this, I'm going to throw them together. So mites and ticks. These are actually mostly parasitic. Some free living. Their mouth parts are modified if they're parasitic. Miscellaneous facts about mites and ticks. Mites, a certain type of mite, I don't remember the name, appear to be in part responsible for the collapse of bee colonies. The ticks, some ticks carry different diseases. Certainly you've probably heard by now of Lyme disease, which affects humans. There's a number of tick-borne diseases that affect dogs and other creatures. So they're not pleasant organisms. Okay, that's the end of this list of characteristics of the arachnids. And we'll continue in the next video clip.